Next on the show, we have one of the San Francisco Bay Area's top producing residential real estate brokers. We're going to learn how we can be massively successful in any market, all while living a life of passion, purpose, and prosperity. My guest, Christopher Stafford, coming up.
Welcome to the Wealth Through Real Estate Investing Podcast, your source for real-world strategies focused on creating long-term wealth, cash flow, and financial freedom through real estate. Through guidance, tips, and stories of highly successful real estate investors and thought leaders, we provide you the tools to succeed and to reach the lifestyle you always wanted. And now, your host, Dwaine Clarke.
Hello and welcome back to the Wealth Through Real Estate Investing Show. This is your host, Dwaine Clarke, and today we have Christopher Stafford. Chris is a 25-year veteran listing agent and founder of The Agent on Leash. Chris is also an author of Massive Abundance. Chris, thank you so much for joining us on the show, and how are you doing, my friend?
I am doing great. Thanks so much for having me, Dwaine.
Absolutely. From the sunny San Francisco, I appreciate you taking the time. And like I said, every time I talk to a new person in a different market, I get really excited because I get like a really insight of how things are going locally, not just kind of like from a national perspective. So I really appreciate you coming on the show. But for people who are not familiar with you, I know you have a book out, you're all over the scene, you know, socially and all that thing and different things like that. But for our audience who are not familiar with your background, can you kind of talk about how you got started, a little bit more about your backstory?
Yeah, I started in real estate, my God, in 1937. It was a long time ago. You know, I started off, Dwaine, as a CPA. I used to work for PriceWaterhouseCoopers. And I did that for 11 years. And quite frankly, I'm sometimes not that quick on the uptake. And it took me 11 years to figure out that I hated that. And I really wanted to do one of my passions. And long story short, a buddy of mine got me into real estate and absolutely love it. It's one of the, I sell real estate, still sell real estate for the last over 25 years here in the city and county of San Francisco. It's one of my greatest passions. I absolutely love it. And but then in addition, I can talk more about it later, but in addition, I started coaching listing agents. And I wrote a book called Massive Abundance, How to Create Passion, Purpose, and Prosperity in Your Life. And I started coaching and masterminding with listing agents all over the country. And that's when I developed the Agent Unleashed Collective, which is a coaching and a mastermind group. And I'm having a ball doing that as well.
Awesome. And you kind of talk us through, like I said, here in Connecticut, we're seeing a lot of change as far as kind of like the residential scene. Can you kind of tell us through what's going on in the San Francisco market right now?
Well, the San Francisco market is absolutely bonkers. It's really super busy, like many markets across the country. We are multiple offers. We have a shortage of inventory here in the city. And even last year in 2020 with the whole pandemic, I thought, oh my God, that's it. My business is going to totally dry up. No, it's one of the best years I've had in over 25 years. We were just super busy. Mm. I have some reasoning, I think, why some people just really decided they wanted to make changes and wanted to make moves. I think a lot of it had to do with the fact, too, that because of the pandemic, in addition to the low interest rates, I think a lot of people really sort of reevaluated what their sense of home was and their purpose for their home. And a lot of people have to work from home. And so a lot of people who were maybe like putting off, you know, buying that home is realizing now how important it really is. And so for that reason, 2020 was crazy for us. And we're starting off 2021 same way, you know, shortage of homes. If you're a listing agent, you're making big bank and multiple offers. It's crazy.
And as far as kind of like investing, like I'm totally like a noob as far as kind of the type of investing marketplace there. I mean, typically a lot of the asset classes that we deal with, they're in like different type of markets like Midwest or like Southeast, but there's some lot of interesting things that's in San Francisco. Can you tell us about the characteristics that is so attractive to you and why people should look to invest there as well?
Well, the thing about San Francisco, Dwaine, is that you're definitely investing for the long run. So it's very difficult in San Francisco to flip properties. So if you're trying to flip a property, whether it's a single family home or a multi-unit building, it's just really difficult. The reason is because our properties are so expensive. My average selling price for my real estate business is a little over $2 million. When you start getting into single family homes and especially multi-unit buildings, you're talking $3-4 to $10 million buildings for a multi-unit building. So the cool thing is that the upside is really in the long-term play. So if you're going to keep a building for 5, 7, 10 years, you're definitely going to make really good money. But you just can't flip it because the rents really aren't commensurate with the cost of the building. So it's really hard to cash flow building. And so that's, you know, one of the things that we use here in San Francisco is we use gross rent multipliers to evaluate the price of properties. And we also use price per square foot. And I show these numbers that people in other parts of the country and they go, well, this is crazy. Why would anybody invest here? Mm-hmm. And the reason why somebody would invest here is because in spite of whoever's the president, in spite of interest rates, in spite of earthquakes, whatever happens in the country, San Francisco is usually, you know, obviously the real estate markets are very cyclical. We have a super strong corporate headquarter presence. We are the first real estate market, especially for investors. We're the first real estate market. The last real estate market to go down in price and the first one to go up in price. So it's a super strong market. And again, for the long term, you know, look at it like this. We're only 7 square miles. We're not manufacturing any more land. Everything is built out. And quite frankly, it's a cool city and it's an icon city all over the world. And so people all over the world know San Francisco. They know the Golden Gate Bridge. And so there's this really strong demand to invest in the city itself.
Yeah, really good points there. As I think about it, that makes a lot of sense there for people to kind of consider, but especially for the long-term hold and things like that.
Yes.
And then kind of switching subject to kind of learn about, because I know you work with a lot of agents in all different types of markets. And I know you've been doing this over 25 years, so you have a tremendous amount of experience. Can you kind of talk about as far as kind of success principles that helped you? I know you've seen ups and downs of different types of stuff and worked through different types of things. What is the traits that a successful listing agent needs in order to be successful, especially as we, you know, head into kind of some market changes?
Successful traits. Wow. That's a good question.
If you can boil it down into
take more than 50 minutes, Dwaine. Now, successful traits. You know, the biggest thing, I think, a couple things. One is, I think it's really super important that you keep your emotions between the lines. So whether you're having a super cool day or whether you're having a day that totally sucks, you really got to figure out a way to keep your emotions in between those lines because, you know, being a listing agent, as most of your listeners know, in San Francisco or anywhere else in the country can be just crazy. But the biggest thing I think is consistency. I think it's super important that you are consistent. And this is one of the things I talk about all the time because, you know, if you're not consistent in your marketing, if you're not consistent with your scripts, with your presentations and everything that you're doing, you know, your pipeline's just going to dry up. And that's the biggest thing that I'm really talking to listing agents all over the country about is what are the things that you can do to really develop a consistent behavior, especially in your marketing? And I'll tell you, one of the things that I really like talking about is minimum standards, because it's really important for all of us listing agents and entrepreneurs. I mean, we're all entrepreneurs starting our own businesses here. It's really super important that you really have minimum standards in terms of what you're going to do. And so one of the first things, I just had a conversation an hour ago with one of my new clients, coaching clients, and we're talking about developing minimum standards of what you can do every single day to bring in new business. And I don't care, and make it really super simple. When I say minimum standards, make it so simple that I don't care if your dog dies, your wife leaves you, your house burns down, that day you're gonna do your minimum standard. And I have some coaching clients that are basically doing listing agents that are calling 3 people a day. That's their minimum standard. Mm-hmm. But the beauty of it is, no matter what you're doing, and you can apply this to anything in life, the beauty of it is that when you're doing it and when you're consistently doing a minimum standard, you're developing really cool habits, number one, but you're also getting more comfortable and confident in what you're doing. And what that leads to, guess what? It leads to wanting to do more of it. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's, to me, it's like the greatest secret for all entrepreneurs, especially listing agents, is develop minimum standards for yourself around your entire business and do those things consistently.
Yeah, I really like that. And it's something that it's so overlooked, but then so simple that you're just saying, like, you know, to the point of just making 3 calls a day, or, you know, sending a letter, or doing something, just consistency, building that habit. Of course, those are the same traits you need to be successful in any business or any endeavor that you do in life. So it's kind of all applies, but simplicity.
Yeah, I know. And Dwaine, a lot of times the real estate agents and listing agents, and I've met many entrepreneurs that I'm friends with. A lot of times, Dwaine, it's like, we're letting the outside world sort of influence us. We're checking our email and, you know, monitoring our email and phone calls and all that kind of stuff. And we're letting other people dictate our schedules. And we have to have the chutzpah to be able to set our own schedule, set our own goals, set our own schedules. And like I said, develop these minimum standards so we know what we're doing. And that's essentially what's going to fill your pipeline with new listings.
And then kind of speaking of that, kind of like routines and being really kind of, you know, cohesive in the things that you do, can you kind of talk about, you know, the typical agent is kind of known for when you see like on TV that they're working 24 hours, they have their cell phone glued to their hip and they're always responsive. Can you kind of talk about, you know, you implementing these type of tactics, how you can be able to really control your time, you know, produce great results for your clients, but also, you know, live a life that you want to live?
Sure. Well, you know, it's sort of funny. I see those things on television and I think those, number one, it's all BS because all that stuff is scripted. And number two, I think that people that really adopt, and I know listing agents that really adopt that kind of persona. And I know one agent in particular down in Beverly Hills, California, and, you know, her whole shtick is, you know, I have beepers and pagers and, you know, all this kind of stuff. And I'm available 24/7 for anything that you need. And I think, well, screw that. You know, I mean, it's, you know, being available 24/7, like you said, you're not going to have a life. What you need to do is develop a really cool schedule that's going to really work for you. It's not the same for everybody. And that's one of the things I work with listing agents on. Develop a schedule that really makes sense for you because, you know, bottom line is we know what we need to be doing. What do we need to be doing as listing agents? We need to be finding new business, writing contracts. If you're working with buyers, work with buyers. And that's really about it. All the other stuff, the non-income producing activities, especially doing files and, you know, whatever else that you got to do, that is all stuff that you can defer, delegate to, you know, other people. There's only those things that we really should be doing. So develop a really super strong schedule. That's really the key. And here's another tip. One of the things that I have found, it took me a little while to sort of figure this out, but one of the things that I sort of found is that, you know, when you start a new client, a relationship with a new client, and you tell that client right off the gate, you know, when you're that first initial interview, you tell them, you know what, I'm going to show your house, you know, Monday through Saturday, and it's going to be between 9 a.m. and 6 p.m., and that's it. And I take Sundays off, or, you know, whatever your shtick is. You know what? They don't care. You know, you don't have to say you're available 24/7. You can set the tone right at the very beginning in your relationship with your clients and tell them, I'm taking these days off. I'm going to spend time with my wife or partner or whatever. And they're totally fine with it. So there's this myth that as an entrepreneur or that as a listing agent that you have to be available 24/7. I say that's hogwash.
Mm. Yeah, I totally agree with that. And I think, you know, you mentioned the clients, I think we respect that. I think they're looking at the end result, and, you know, and if you're able to kind of set those rules and boundaries right from the get-go, you have a better relationship because then you're not going to be promising stuff that you know you can't fulfill, and something pops up or you have to meet with your spouse and then you can't do it, and you have a, you know, kind of ruin the relationship there. So it's really to kind of establish that from the get-go.
Yeah,
and that's
absolutely
really important.
No doubt.
Absolutely. And now, can you kind of talk about, you had mentioned that part of your coaching is like a mastermind element of like-minded agents together to, you know, I did this and kind of keep each other accountable. Can you kind of talk about the power of masterminds and what do you help agents in your group?
Yeah, I love mastermind groups. I am probably a member of 3 mastermind groups right now. I have been in mastermind groups for so long. Mastermind groups are so powerful because, well, like what you said, you're getting together periodically with people that are similar to you and have the same goals as you. But when you meet with other people, it's like, you know, what you're doing with your show and what, which is just amazing for all the people that are listening. You're giving them new information. You're motivating them. You're incenting them. You're getting great new ideas. You're finding out what other agents are doing that's working. And quite frankly, the better part is what is not working. You know, mm-hmm. Are you doing Facebook ads? Or are you doing mailings? What's working? What's not working? And part of my program, the Agent Unleashed Collective, is I, number one, I do one-on-one coaching with them. But the other thing is every 2 weeks we get on a Zoom call, and I have agents all over the country, and we just get on the phone and talk about that. We talk about, you know, what's working, what's not working, what can we learn differently, how can we change our business, you know, that kind of thing. And it's a lot of fun. We're super goofy. We have a lot of fun, a lot of jokes and all that kind of stuff. And the beauty of it is, as much as I would love to work with listing agents, you know, that are listening to this right now, you don't have to join a mastermind group. You can start your own mastermind group. I personally think it would be a great idea for you to find real estate agents, which is really super easy to do. Find real estate agents in other marketplaces, maybe in different states or different cities, and call them up and say, hey, do you want to jump on the phone twice a month and just talk a little bit about, you know, our businesses and how we can help each other? And, you know, for me personally, I think it's just such a powerful thing that you can do, because it gives you a different perspective on how other agents are operating their businesses. Because, as you know, Dwaine, you know, we're all like sort of, we're entrepreneurs by ourselves on an island. We don't have a lot of opportunities to really talk to other entrepreneurs and figuring out what works and what doesn't work. So start your own mastermind group. It's, you will not regret it at all. And it's the best thing you'll do.
Absolutely. And then one thing that I've been kind of keen off of what you've been saying is that kind of the masterminds and the coaching and kind of doing those three things, or those, you know, minimal standards, in order to get more control over your life and be able to kind of structure your business that can lead to, you know, like your book of abundance and prosperity. Can you kind of talk about your, about life of passion and purpose and how all of that is kind of interconnected, as far as kind of having a good, healthy business, which then leads to, you know, prosperity and abundance?
Sure. Well, I think, you know, I think what it's really important is to be passionate about what you're doing in life. And quite frankly, a lot of times you can't be passionate and do something and make a lot of money doing it within that passion. Sometimes what you can do is you can figure out a way to incorporate your passions into your business. But this is one of the reasons I got out of being a CPA. When I was a CPA, I absolutely felt like I was going home crying on the inside. I was really good at it. I made a lot of money doing it, and I hated it. And when I went into real estate, because I knew real estate was my passion, I was really fortunate that I was able to do really well financially and every other way with real estate, and it's one of my passions. But if you can't do that, figure out a way to incorporate your passions into your business. For instance, I am one real estate agent I know, their passion is flying airplanes. I mean, they are lucky enough that they have the money and the time that they can fly their own private airplane. And so what they do is they take clients up in this airplane. It's a great hook that they use to get real estate clients by using his airplane. So there's a lot of different ways you can sort of incorporate your passion into your business. But the bottom line is if you're passionate about something, you're going to do a lot more. You're going to get really good at it. You're going to make a lot of money doing it. And the whole basis of my book essentially is really being so prosperous and so successful in all areas of your life, not just about money, but, you know, with relationships and your health and spiritually and mentally and all that kind of stuff. The essence of my book is that when you get so good at everything that you then, it's like a big circle, you turn around and give it all back. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the things that I really love about my coaching group, because one of my passions is seeing other real estate agents listening to me and taking my advice and doing really well and reaching new levels and doing shows like this. And I'm sure you experience the exact same thing, Dwaine, doing calls when I'm on the phone and people are getting what I'm saying and it's really improving their life. You know, it brings me so much joy. I can live off that, Dwaine, for days. So I love it. Absolutely love it.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome. Well, I kind of have this section in the interview to kind of get to know the guest, the entrepreneur, a little bit more. And it's very been impactful. And a lot of our guests, our audience been getting a lot out of it. So I want to kind of learn a little bit more about like a typical work day for you. And do you have any special morning routines?
Absolutely. Almost every single morning I have a routine in that I get up early. I pretty much get up at zero dark 30, Dwaine. I'm usually up between 4 and 4:30 every morning. This morning I got up at 3:30. I know it's pretty sick. But the first thing I do is I meditate. I usually meditate for about 20 minutes. It's a guided meditation. Then I used to go swim. I'm a big swimmer, but since all the pools are closed, now what I do is I do some yoga and I do push-ups, sit-ups, and that kind of exercises here at home. And then I go for a walk. I walk with my partner for 5 miles every single morning, which is about 10,000 steps for me. And then when I come back, eat a nutritious breakfast. And then what I do is I literally write down my goals.